Pursuits of exquisite pleasure have come down to us through the ages as compelling tales of glamour, ardour, luxury and loyalty, providing us with illuminating and cautionary tales of greed and arrogance, ultimately ending in either high tragedy or blood-drenched dust. The consorts of the kings of France were mostly chosen for political advantage, and they were often quite devoid of physical beauty. Mistresses, on the other hand, were usually chosen because of it, and also to provide for the sovereign's amorous dalliance and amusement, and in some cases, this turned to devoted love. Diane de Poitiers, by the age of 16, was very sure of her own worth. Her complexion was described as being clear pink with white skin, her hair chestnut, almond-shaped brown eyes, the delicate nose slightly tilted, with an intelligent expression full of enigma. It is also recorded that she was very beautiful, extremely intelligent, with a strong will as well as strength of purpose, all very necessary attributes for surviving in the world of political intrigues that surrounded those who were members of any royal court, including that of Francois I. Born on New Year's Eve in 1499, her blood and destiny were linked with the powerful House of Bourbon. Like most children of her time, she was born into a certain status in life and sent away when she was 6 years of age to be educated in the house of a kinswoman, Anne, the Duchess of Bourbon. Anne educated Diane about the dignity of her rank, the deportment that became it, and encouraged her and the other girls she was lodged with about acquiring a finesse of mind, how to be skillful, subtle, and with a delicacy of taste, and most importantly, an acute awareness of the traditions into which she had been born. Anne knew that a period of struggle was beginning for women, so in order to sustain the girls in her care, she made sure that they were well versed in Latin as well as fluent in their own French language. It was expected they should be able to converse well with adults by the age of 7, and by the age of 13, they were expected to marry. The group of children Diane grew up in included the young Mary Stuart, who later became Queen of Scotland. The ideas they were taught are those of their time, one in which it was considered that although between men and women the functions were different, the virtues should remain the same. A woman of rank was expected to know medicine and cooking as well as to be intellectual. During the learning period, Diane not only acquired a taste for fine books, but also a disdain for low political intrigues and the frivolous nature of many women of her station. Diane de Poitiers became a model from which the Renaissance took its 9 laws of beauty. 3 things white, the skin, the teeth, the hands. 3 black, the eyes, the eyebrows, the eyelashes. 3 red, the lips, the cheeks, the nails. 3 long, the body, the hair, the hands. 3 short, the teeth, the ears, and the feet. 3 narrow, the mouth, the waist, and the ankle. 3 big, the arms, the thighs, and the calf. 3 small, the breast, the nose, and the head. At 16 years of age, she was married to Louis de Breze, a confidant of the king and governor of Normandy. Together, they shared political ideals and a love of horse riding. From childhood, she had safeguarded her health in a discipline that was maintained throughout her life. Every morning at 3 a.m., she rose and took a bath of cold water, then went for a 3-hour horse ride. She went back to bed for solitude and relaxation, eating sparingly, then rising late in the morning and giving the rest of her day over to society. Her advantageous marriage brought her into the household of Queen Claude of France, one that was faithful to tradition and where everything was modesty, decency, and even austerity. Surrounded by good works, the Queen spent most of her time spinning, making tapestry, living apart from the King, who visited only occasionally to give her some attention, no confidences, a little consideration, and 7 children. When Diane was 18, Francois I's second son was born on the last day of March 1518. He became Henri, Duke d'Orléans, and in the main was ignored by his father during his childhood in favour of his elder brother, the Dauphin, Francis, who was heir to the throne. Diane had 2 daughters, and in 1523, her family survived a treasonous act by her father against the crown. Her husband, not knowing who was behind it, denounced the plot, saving the throne and his own family. Following his defeat for the crown of the Holy Roman Empire by the Spanish king, Francois I retained his enmity against Charles V, the Holy Roman Emperor, for all of his life. In February 1525, he was defeated by Charles at the Battle of Pavia, fought on Spanish soil, and taken captive in Madrid until he made major concessions. He was freed on the 17th of March 1526, but Charles insisted on exchanging him for his 2 sons and heirs as hostages. The 2 French princes, aged only 7 and 9, were detained for nearly 5 years in Spain as hostages in their father's continual struggles with Charles V. In 1530, they were released, and it was Diane that Francois asked to greet them. Henri, the youngest, was greatly distressed by the whole experience and would remember her kindness. At a great fete and tournament held to honour their return, Henri, who was only 12, entered the lists wearing her colours of black and white, saluting and dedicating his first feats to her. She was 30 at the time. At the family chateau of Annay in 1531, King Francois and Louis de Brise, who was now also governor of Normandy, planned to marry Henri off to the Pope's niece, Catherine de Medici. A few days later, Louis de Brise fell asleep at the age of 72 and was given a funeral of great honour. Diane erected a mausoleum to her husband at Rouen with the inscription, "Louis de Brise, Diane grieving for the death of her husband, has raised this sepulchre to thee, once thy inseparable and most faithful wife. What she was in thy bed, she will be in the tomb." She took to wearing only black and white, and it became her style and a symbol of her loyalty to her husband. It is thought that around 1533, 2 years after her husband's death, she took as her lover the young Prince Henri, who was completely devoted to her. Theirs turns into one of the great love affairs of history, a lifelong liaison of passion and loyalty, one to the other. It was on October 27, 1533, that Catherine de' Medici, at aged only 14, made her entry to Marseille to a salute of 300 guns. She had come to marry Henri, and it would be fair to say it certainly created great difficulties when Francois I gave Diane the responsibility of assisting young Catherine to learn the good fashions of France. However, war broke out again with Spain, and the Dauphin was seized by a fever at Tournon after drinking iced water, and he died. Now history would be altered, and the Medici family at Florence gained what they desired, a niece who would be Queen of France. At the same time, Diane had as her lover the man who would be king. Diane de Poitiers inherited her father's estates, and a whole series of documents testify to their able administration. She was not only beautiful to look at, but also clever, resourceful, and extremely competent. At the Chateau Anet, Francois I, architect Philibert d'Elorme, 1510 to 1570, spent 10 years carrying out works there for her, using a great number of articles and quantities of materials that had been brought from Paris for its adornment. D'Elorme is an architect of central importance in France for having established an essentially French version of Classicism. A humanist and student of the antique, he designed the tomb of Francois I in the cathedral at Saint-Denis. D'Elorme wrote two books on architecture, printed in 1561 and 1567. His patroness, Diane de Poitiers, aligned herself with the goddess of the hunt, Diana in Roman mythology or Artemis in Greek mythology, and her symbol, the crescent moon, featured in the decoration at the Chateau Anet. D'Elorme had an inventive style that can be well appreciated at the entrance gateway to Diana's chateau. It was a novel variant of the triumphal arch, treated in a sculptural way. Henri II lent workmen for Diana's project, and the royal arsenal was responsible for casting the great stag and the dogs that crowned the portico of the entrance. Above the door, a clock shows the hours inside the chateau, the signs of the zodiac, daily movement of the moon and planets, the chime sounds before the hours, half hours and quarters, imitating the baying of four hounds instead of bells. The goddess is shown reclining above the entrance door, and along the roof ridge, Diane's celestial ensign, a crest of crescents. The entrance is emphasized by unusual chimneys in the form of antique sarcophagi. Over the small doors, the terraces are enriched with strapwork decoration. D'Elorme used the Greek Doric order, which was made from Vernon stone, and the knocker on the door is a crescent upon a triangle. The significance for Anet's part in the garden design story is that it was essentially the first garden where French designers were employed to carry out architectural design of both house and garden, rather than using Italian imports. Jehane carved a sculpture of his patroness as the huntress, Diana, which was placed in the gardens. Michelangelo was brought to France from Italy in 1529, and he placed a statue of Hercules in the fountain courtyard at the Chateau of Anet. D'Elorme had spent 3 years at Rome, and in the 1530s he designed the garden according to Italian architect Alberti's principles of a single composition and cohesive design. As many other gardens, Anet's Renaissance galleried parterre, the pavilions and bathing pool were all destroyed a century later. The tapestries on the walls each side of the fireplace in the dining salon reproduce fragments of the history of the goddess Diana. In her bedroom, the bed has an elaborately carved bedhead and was raised on a platform to indicate its importance, dressed with curtains for privacy. Like all well-bred women of her time, Diane de Poitiers knew that in order to offset the whiteness of her skin and make herself attractive, she should lie on black satin sheets to add to her allure. For Henry, she created a magic circle of which she was the enchantress, and she was, without question, the most sumptuous person in Europe of her age. Henri became King of France in 1547. On the day of his consecration, he wore a doublet enriched at the slashes with embroidery of pearls that were 4 fingers wide with 3 crescents intertwined, carrying the cipher of the double D linked and joined with an H. This device affirmed in the sight of all that before being a king he was a man and that his lady was in his thoughts. In 1548, he gave Diane de Poitiers a chateau in the Loire in memory of her late husband's services to the crown, investing her with the lands of Saint-Vallier and the title of Duchess de Valentinois, Dame Saint-Vallier for life. Chenonceau is a chateau built and run by women, 7 in fact, all of whom added to the estate and its treasures through business sense and savvy. Through their able administration in agriculture, forestry, viticulture, horticulture, and administration, Chenonceau has become a monument to their matters of taste and skill. It was originally conceived and built between 1513 and 1521 for the private financier, Thomas Bonheur, on instructions given by his wife Catherine, who herself had come from a family of wealthy financiers. Francois I, who had visited it twice, appropriated it from their son following both their deaths, and he gave it to Henry II. Together with her architect Philibert Delorme, Diane set about remodelling the chateau in a sensitive way, to the point that it became known as one of the architectural jewels of the Loire Valley. The Chateau Chenonceau retained one of its medieval towers to demonstrate the age of the estate and the noble character of the site. It had a revolutionary change of facade. Each story was ornamented with flat pilasters bounded by strong horizontal string courses, with dormers being a prominent feature jutting out from the roof. The new chateau was built directly over the Cher, on the piers of what had been the estate's water mill. A barrel vault joined these piers to form a rectangular platform to hold the main structure, which is square in plan with turrets at the four corners and an H-shaped roof, all of which create an interesting play of volumes and shapes. The interior spaces were cleverly and clearly defined to allow masses of light into the interior and to bring the landscapes outside in, the windows all having a vista of water and trees. Diane provided some of the most spectacular and modern gardens of the era, where a multitude of species decorated a subtle geometry of beds and paths punctuated with fountains. Henri II died suddenly while participating in a tournament, receiving a lance through the eye. Catherine barred Diane from his bedchamber, arranging for his interment in a cenotaph on which she placed an inscription bearing only her name. Catherine claimed Chenonceau, offering Diane the Chateau Chaumont, which she graciously accepted. When Diane withdrew from the court, they say its smile disappeared. She died at Annay in 1566, age 66 years, and her children built her a handsome mausoleum, inscribed, "She had been kind to her husband, to whom she had been faithful, kind to her daughters, whom she had made rich. She had loved a king who had adored and respected her and made her happy." And now it's time for us to take a break until part 3 of the French Renaissance.